The objective of this tutorial is to study a C# ASP.NET Core Web Application, and we will start by creating an empty project. After that, we will also study what is app versus host configuration. We will try to understand these terms, and we will also be introduced to iHost. These are the basic parts, basic concepts of ASP.NET Core that will help us develop our understanding. We will start by creating an empty web application. For that, create a new project. Open Visual Studio. Select ASP.NET Core Web Application template like we have done here. Then click OK. You get this dialog, this box, this page you will get. Type a name for your project and keep other defaults. Whatever is there, let us not change it. Click OK. Click Next. Then you will get another box here. Here you should select empty. Select empty. An empty project is the best way to learn a new technology. That is why we will select empty here. This is option for authentication. We are not selecting any authentication. The basic purpose once again is that we keep our things as simple as possible. And here you will see an advanced like this area, configure for HTTPS. This is tick marked. Why are we doing this? We are adding support for HTTP secure. All the websites these days are secure HTTPS. So we will start by tick marking it. We will study projects for HTTPS only. The consequence of this will be that your project will be run by HTTPS localhost. This S will be there. In the browser, this story will be typed to run your project. And this will also configure a digital certificate on this machine when you run it for the first time. You will have to do OK, OK, and it will configure it for you. That's not a big issue. And after you have done everything, you will get this box. This window will be made for you. Solution Explorer. And let us study what this window has to offer us. First of all, the empty project that we have obtained is a generic project. Generic project means that if I have written start of an ASP.NET Core web application, now basically the topic heading is ASP.NET Core web application, but at the start I'm going to tell you that this is not restricted to writing ASP.NET Core or HTTP workloads. You can do other things also. For example, you can create console applications or long-lived services. It is not necessary that you use this basic template for an ASP.NET Core application. It is not necessary. You can create services also. A service will process requests. That is a different story. They are background services. We can use this to create them only. But we, in our present tutorials, or for the whole point of this course that we are taking, we will be necessarily including a service for ASP.NET Core that will handle HTTP or HTTPS requests for us. ASP.NET Core is one of the services, but apart from this, you can use it for other services also. And today only I will be explaining you how this can be done and this also can be done in this project. Now this is something that you should be aware of. There are four files that basically have been entered here. One file is startup.cs, second file is program.cs, then appsettings.json, and its companion is also there, .development.json. And under properties there is one more file, launchsettings.json. So let us study them briefly, what they are about. Startup.cs file, what is the purpose of this file? As I told you, this project can be used for writing other services also and for writing ASP.NET Core web application also. Startup.cs file will contain code for configuring our web service. Which web service? Our ASP.NET Core web service. Since we are studying ASP.NET Core, this startup file will contain program that will help us to configure our web service for ASP.NET. Without going into all the details, we are taking overview right now. Our next file is program.cs. Program.cs file, let us see what is the use of this file. If we open this file by double clicking, this is the only piece of code written there. Public class program, public static void main, this followed by something here and followed by something here. This is another method in the same program class. This program.cs file, therefore, it contains the entry point. This is the entry point. We will discuss it later, but to show you what program.cs actually contains, it contains our main function, and from the main function or main method, our program will start, and this is the starting, the launch, the entry point of our project. We will discuss threadbare everything later on. After that, we have appsettings.json file, or JSON file as we pronounce it. What does it contain and how does it look like? If you double click and open that file, you will see this JSON format, logging, log level, defaults, Microsoft, whatever. These are some things that will be there. We can discuss them later on. What is the basic purpose of this file? This file contains log settings like log level. So you can see log level here. We will discuss log level later on. So this is one thing. Then it can also include key value pairs for any sort of data. Although we have not shown any data here, when you open the empty project, about this is the only thing that will be shown there. But you can optionally add any key value pairs or any sort of custom data by using JSON notation and putting it inside the app settings file. Now additional files, companion files can be appsettings.development.json. As you must have seen here, we were showing. Apart from this, it can be .staging, .json, and .production, .json. So it contains settings for different environments. as a developer, this will be used. For staging, this will be used. For production, this will be used. We will discuss all that as we go, but the whole point is that app settings file, this contains settings for this particular application project. Then another file is launchsettings.json or JSON. Now what does this contain? If you double click and open, you will see this sort of JSON, a complicated story written here. But in nutshell, let me explain. First of all, I'll start here. This file contains host settings for IIS settings, for authentication, anonymous Windows, and URL that will be used for serving the requests, localhost followed by port. SSL port will also be written here. You can identify. Then variables like ASP.NET Core underscore environment. These variables are also defined somewhere in this file. Why are these variables here? These variables are used by our methods that we will be discussing today or maybe in our next lecture. This same name variable can be present on the computer, machine, server. From there it will be read. If it is to be overridden, to be replaced, then its value can be rewritten inside this file. Which file? This file that we are discussing. Inside this file, launch settings file, you can override the machine variable here. The most important thing is the launch settings file is only used on the local development machine, only for the Visual Studio. It is not deployed. So this is basically during testing environment only. This will not go to your server. To your server, app settings file will go, and of course other CS files, they will go in compiled form. So roughly with this and this file. Now there is a term that is used in case of settings. This is application setting, this is host setting. Now there is a term used, app settings or host settings. We will try to understand the difference between them. This is a very important interview question also, and let us see what is basically an app setting and what is host setting. See, this is app settings and this you can say is host settings. What is the difference? Let us see the comparison. App configuration on this side, host configuration on this side. Clear. Items for app configuration are logging and key value custom data. Items for host configuration are the name of the application, the environment like development, staging or production, content root. Content root means the current working directory, and Kestrel server. Basically anything related to the hosting, and this is anything related to the current application. App configuration is read from app settings.json file. Host configuration can be specified by calling various methods that I will explain surely. I'm keeping it simple today. And optionally, during development, it can be read from the launch settings.json file. So if you open this file on your own Visual Studio, you will see all this story mentioned somewhere in the launch settings file, as he explained today immediately before this also. Now let us study the program.cs file. ASP.NET Core application starts from the main function, the usual main function that is similar to a WinForms or a WPF application that you must have already done. So what does this contain? This contains public class program, and there is a main method that is written inside it. Let us try to understand what all means. We say we are not discussing what is written inside main. We say I host created, configured, and run here. What is I host and what is configuration and what is running? Let me explain it briefly. I host is an interface that has to be implemented by an object. That object is created here, it is configured here, and it runs here. It keeps running, and let me now explain the details of this story. Now see, I host, this object is created inside main. There is only one line of code. First of all, there is only one line of code inside the main function. There is only one line of code. That is very interesting. Now an iHost implementation is instantiated, created, configured, and run here, and stops on this. I'll take a bit later. Let me first of all tell you what is an iHost. An iHost is an object that contains related resources of your application. Single object that contains related resources. For what? It contains dependency injection configuration. Dependency injection I'll discuss later, but in a rough loose language, it is global objects available everywhere through your project. For logging, for configuration, and I hosted service implementations. This I am coming in a moment. Basically, a host object, it contains dependency injection story, logging, configuration, and the fourth item that it contains is I hosted service objects. It contains a collection of further objects which implement iHosted service interface. This might look a bit complicated to you at start. Again, I'll repeat: dependency injection story, logging configuration, the general host configuration, app configuration, and all that. And apart from this, it contains a collection of objects that implement iHosted service. Just give me a moment, we'll come to the details of this today only. But before this, let me summarize it so that confusion doesn't grow. This main, this place, it contains an object of iHost. iHost contains configuration, and it also contains a collection of more objects. What are those more objects? See, in today's lecture at the start, I told you that this solution explorer that we created is not meant alone for your web service, for ASP.NET Core web service. You can have other services also. So if you are running certain background service, then that service will be hooked, or will not be hooked, will be attached to a iHost, to its collection of iHosted services. So that will be attached to this collection, and your main ASP.NET Core web service, that will obviously also be attached to this iHosted service. Still Some confusion will be there, but just give me a moment. I'll come to the details of this one once again in a moment. Now, an iHost implementation is created, configured, and run here. That is a blocking call. Block means that it will not exit. It will continue to stay in that. So because single object is there, if this were not to block, then the program would end immediately. It is a blocking call. Run function is a blocking call which stops when a control C event is received on the console. Where you are running that Kestrel, you will see later on that a sort of a console application is running. Either it is stopped by a control C, or it is stopped by a SIGTERM signal. Basically, in nutshell, it means that it continues to run until it is stopped. Okay. Now, this is what we have studied so far. Before I proceed further, I'll explain why. Why is it a single object that contains so many things? Why are we only creating a single object that is containing so many things? If you remember your Windows form application, you have a single due form, form 1 or something like that. This form 1 contains all the controls, button, everything. Then they are disposed of. When the form goes out, your application stops and they are disposed of. There is a single class. This class contains all the objects. And when this form 1 disposes of, all of them are disposed of gracefully. The same story goes here also. iHost is a single object. And the explanation that is given to us is, why a single object? Lifetime management and control over app startup and graceful shutdown. This is an interview question which they might ask in case you are going for that. Now let us talk about iHosted services. These iHosted services, iHost contains a collection of iHosted services. The basic point is I'm introducing about this main story. So iHost is containing a collection of iHosted services. Let me explain what is this. So iHost, I told you, it contains a story for dependency injection, for logging also, for configuration also, and how it contains, how it happens, we will talk in our next lecture, but you can get a rough idea about what it is now. The fourth thing I told you was it contains iHosted service implementations. Now what is this? This is what we are talking now. If we study the properties of iHost interface, of course this is iHost only we are talking here. If we study the documentation on MSDN, Microsoft documentation on iHost, you will find the property as services. The programs configured services. Services is a collection, plural. This is a collection that contains iHosted service implementations. So iHost contains a collection of iHosted service. Example, it could contain a background worker. And necessarily for our story, the web service that starts the ASP.NET Core HTTP server. And by the way, as I told you, there is a run method that keeps the story running. Let me talk about that also before I close that tutorial. iHost documentation contains extension methods. One of the extension methods is run. runs an application and blocks the calling thread until the host shutdown. That control C command and all. iHost contains a run extension method, and what happens inside that run? The run method calls start async of each iHosted service. Start async is a method on your ASP.NET service. It is a method on other services that you want to run. The run method will call fire all of them, and run will block exit only when it is destroyed by external events, control C and all. So before I close, let me finally tell that this project, as I told in the beginning also, will not necessarily contain an ASP.NET core story, core service. It can contain other services also. How we are going to include other services? How we are going to attach your ASP.NET core service to your iHost? That we will talk in the next lecture. And as I was telling, other services only may be attached. Your core web ASP.NET core HTTP service is also to be attached, but it is optional. Whichever services are present in iHost on run, it blocks and it calls start async method of each of the iHosted services. This is the basic story that goes on here. In our next lecture, I will take up the details further, because a longer lecture is a bit difficult. So I will take in the next lecture. The fundamentals still continue. Thank you.